Hey guys, today we're going to wire up a transfer tank. Hey guys, so we have this transfer tank and this ram, and the cool thing about it is they've had these brackets welded up, and that way it can bolt directly to the headache rack. So a lot of times what you'll see is there'll be a flange, but then you're putting holes into your bed. So I thought that was pretty neat. So our job today is to wire this up in a way that it's still removable, but it looks like it's part of the truck. Now, if this was a little bit more of a permanent setup, what we would have done is we could have tapped the underside of the headache rack, we could have taken it out, and then we could have put in some sort of P-clip and then stainless steel hardware to hold it in. However, we want this to be easy to remove, so what we've elected to do is we still want the wire to be nice and tucked with the headache rack, but we just put a small hole here and put a zap strap in, so when we unbolt here, we just have to cut it off. The reason why we're thinking is we want to be able to take this out with basic hand tools. If I put the fasteners underneath, you're going to need angle drivers, some sort of special tool to get under here, and if you're out in the field, you might not have that with you as opposed to having it in your shop. So by doing this, you get to get some pliers from cutters, and then you have your wrenches and sockets, and just unbolt it and cut it out. Now the way these things are set up, they give you the conduit and they wire directly into the motor, and then you wire to the battery. So we want to disconnect. So here we are using a 2-pin trailer connector, and I'm going to show you the orientation is very important. So what we're doing here is it's all soldered with dielectric grease on here and shrink tube and tape. So you can see we have a loom on here and exterior tesla tape, and to help hold the tesla tape on, we've put shrink tube on each end, that way if it doesn't want to unravel. So what we're doing over here is the 2-pin on the positive side on the truck has insulation over it. So if we unplug this, if the switch is on, this wire is hot, it can't touch anything and arc out on the frame. So on this side, the exposed portion is positive, but it doesn't matter. When we put the plug on, everything's insulated. Here's how everything looks underneath the loom. So if you guys want to refer, I have another video for outside solder connections, and I go through all the steps how to achieve this. So the beauty about this is you don't have to think, you just plug it in. So underneath this again is for ease. So what we did here is we just found some holes, just zap strap with good quality zap straps, and just cut them out if you need to remove it. Okay, so we're finishing up our connections. So it's crimped. I use a different crimper for the larger gauge wire. We solder it as well, and we shrink tube it. So I make the connections inside. There's nothing wrong with running the ground inside as long as the wire is sufficient in terms of handling the amperage, because now we don't have to handle like weathering, dirt, moisture, anything, because the cab is much more controlled than outside the vehicle. So we went through a factory grommet over here. That's where you came through the firewall. And the nice thing about it, because this is a Cummins Ram, you don't have to worry about heat because the exhaust manifold is on the passenger side. So over here we have ground. So this is the fastener for the factory amp, same place where the factory's grabbed a bunch of grounds. And then over here you can see our relays. So we've mounted that to the subframe as well. And then you can see here's our power coming off it. So I figured it'd be easier to show you guys on the bench how the relay's wired up. So this is a single pole double throw relay. This is a Bosch style. They don't make these anymore. So if you ever find these, treat them like gold or mail them to me. This one can handle up to 30 amps, no problem, it says right here. So what we have done is the relay is hooked up, so 87, pin 87 is hooked up to battery. And then we have 30 is driving our device. So 30 is the positive of our pump. And then we have 85 going to ground. You can share the same ground as the pump. We, like I showed you guys before, we ran ground inside of the vehicle because we don't want it to corrode over time, and the wire that we use is nice and thick, it can handle it. So what we have is 86 is on our switch. So the switch, I recommend you do not run power from the battery through the switch. It's just not a good idea. Relays are designed for isolating and running a device. It's a much better way. That way you can have low current in the interior. That way you're not running high current all over the place. And most of these switches, unless it's like a huge switch, it can't really handle high amperage anyways. So the reason why we have ours on positive, I typically don't do this, but we wanted to run with ignition. So our ignition sort, you can run a negative trip and then have, you can have this on like 86 on negative, a negative trip switch, and then you can run 85 over to ignition source. As long as one side is getting negative, the other side is getting positive, it'll energize. But we had to run positive through our switch because it has a light. And we wanted the light and everything to work with the key. So if you don't care about the light, this is how I like to wire to keep my stuff consistent. 86 is always positive. It doesn't matter. You can make 86 positive or negative, but that's just how I like to do it. So if I ever have to reference my work, I know what's what. So we could do 86 to ignition positive, and that way it only works with the key. And then we can run our switch to ground if it's just a regular switch like this. That way, if any of our aftermarket wiring were to chafe, it's just going to be ground. You're not going to pop any fuses or anything. So there's a variety of ways you guys can wire this. That's just how I like to. So that way you guys know how we've done it in this particular truck. So here's our switches. I typically don't like doing switches in the big panels like this, but there was already a round red switch here, which looked really out of place, and the previous owner had some sort of lighting system. So we have these black ones. Now, flush-mounted switches are the way to go, but you don't have that much room when they're in this close proximity because the ends might hit. So we elected for these. Now, the nice thing that we have here is these switches will only operate for ignition. So the other part of our relay is actually hooked up over here. Now, this particular power part only turns on with ignition. So if you ever take the keys out, you don't accidentally leave it on. So you see all our wiring is tucked away here. But the other thing that we do is we add a little bit of lume here and add some strip chalk to help hold it on to avoid any chafing. Let's go ahead and test this out. Now when the tank's empty, we don't want to run it for that long because you have to factor in that the contents of the tank, which would be diesel fuel in this case, is going to help lubricate that pump. So there you guys go. So that's one way you can wire up an auxiliary tank. So what do you guys do? Would you do it similar to this, or do you have it more permanent, or do you have it even more removal than we do? Comment below, I'd like to know.